Guys, today I'm kind of mixing this up and doing something a lot like the zombie survival kit, something that's a little bit more fun, a little bit more fun and a little bit less serious, but at the same time kind of serious. And as the title of this video was, this is my military survival kit. Now what I mean by this is that I'm going to set kind of the scenario, I'm going to be trying to essentially use as much military gear as I can, and the most important thing is kind of have this dualistic mindset where this is the kit that I would want if I was dropped behind enemy lines, or if I somehow found myself behind enemy lines, this is the gear I would want. And the reason why and how I'm staggering, or the gear that you'll be seeing in here, is essentially two-staged gear that's not bad or really actually pretty good at outdoors and survival tasks, but also gear that can second in defensive tasks, because whenever you're behind enemy lines, you always have to think about this other possibility of the fact of being attacked, trying to be captured. So it's more than just escape, evasion, and survival. There's also a possibility that you may have to attack back. So with this kind of kit, this is essentially the scenario that if you're behind enemy lines, if you are truly running from an enemy, or if you have to evade an enemy and possibly maybe get an engagement with them, these are the kinds of tools and the kind of gear that at least I would want. So without any further ado, let's get started. Guys, keep in mind, please share the video. It always really helps when you guys share the videos. So first off, and as I've been doing with a lot of my different kit videos that are this big, I'm going to be getting into what's on my body. Now, once again, with this comprehensive of a kit, there's not actually going to be that much on my body, but there are going to be a handful of very vital things. And so let me swing this pack around, of course, obviously, because I'm in all my winter gear here. I don't have any of the stuff on my body, but this is the stuff that would be on my body in this scenario. So the first thing and the most notable thing I hope you guys can see is a Glock 21. Now, I don't know if I would truly select a Glock 21 in particular. This is just the Glock I have. If I'd had like an infinite choice of the different Glocks I could get, I'd probably actually choose something like a Glock 17 or a Glock 20, because those would probably be slightly better for this particular scenario. But I have a Glock 21, and so that's what I'm going to be using, at least as a stand-in. But I would definitely choose some sort of Glock. Glocks are excellent weapons and really great handguns. Just overall, it's very hard to destroy them, very hard to get them to stop working. And the reason why I have the Glock, this is probably the only just straight defensive tool I have, but that's because, as you'll see with my rifle is not an extremely or particularly capable rifle for a combative situation. And so as a last resort, as an absolute last resort, I do have a handgun, and you'll see more in here for this. And so that's the first thing I have on body. It's a Glock of sorts, but that one in particular is a 21, which the 21's not a bad choice either. Just kind of heavy, doesn't carry as many rounds either. So anyways, now onto the belt knife. And this is the belt knife. It is a Pull Force Prepper 1. I chose this knife because, one, it's actually pretty lightweight. Two, it's very stout, very survivally. And thirdly, it is pretty combative, and I would be rocking it scout style for ultra low profile, and having it be very streamlined to the body. And once again, you know, this is a very great knife for outdoor tasks and, you know, every day-to-day duties of crafting things, batoning, you know, the different things that survivalists and bushcrafters do, but once again, with a more tactical-esque thing, or kind of tactical-esque to it, and you could push it into tactical functions. So now on to the two neck knives. So both of these are quite tactical. The first one, sorry, there's three things still left. I totally forgot about the ferro rod. But here is the first of the neck knives. It is an SE3. And once again, if you guys haven't seen my testing on the SE3, I've been very impressed with this little SE3. So that's why actually all that testing has really helped me come to the conclusion that I really actually would love to have this. Once again, it's another very lightweight option, very lightweight, very capable for bushcraft survival tasks, but if pushed into the roll, it would make an excellent combat knife as well. Just a little bit thin, but once again, I'm not that worried about the thinness being a problem. So then the next neck knife I have here is the Pullforce November 1. And this knife is not as good of a bush knife. I have definitely used it in that capacity, and it does work as a bush knife. It's not the best, but unarguably, this is a very combative knife, and so that's why it makes the list for neck knives, especially when I figure that I already have two very good outdoors knives that are quite capable at just the different daily tasks. I can begin to get a little bit more tactical as far as the knives go. Then lastly, and there's not actually a huge fire element to this kit. That's just because, as I've learned from different tactical operator people who truly go over and see war and see fight, it's not a very smart idea to start fires. And as you guys can probably tell, you know, fires have a very distinct smell. They emulate smoke and flames that you can't control. And so overall, they're not a very good idea. So I have a handful of ferro rods throughout this pack. I think I actually only have two, maybe three, so I really don't have that many, but the one that I do have on body is the very trusty Exotac Nano Striker XL. Just this pouch here is already open. I have a few things in here. Primarily, I just have paracord in here, but another thing, and I've kind of wrapped it up in a little bit of denim, is just tripwire. I thought tripwire would be really nice because tripwire is the general basis for all traps that are like explosive and more deadly, I guess you could say. They're also very good for the traps that tend to be alarms, and that's what I was really going more for with this tripwire, is to be able to create a perimeter around wherever you're currently staying so that you could either be alarmed when someone comes into it or your area, or you can set up a tripwire for whenever you leave, so that when you come back to your camp area, wherever you're, you know, at, you'll know if someone's been there or if someone has not been there via tripwire. So I really like tripwire more as a detection kind of thing, where you can either be alarmed when someone comes to your grounds, or you can know if someone's been there. So that's a very important thing in my opinion. Then once again, I have 100 feet of paracord, because paracord's awesome, very useful, need to have it. So nextly, and this is generally my camera bag when we're talking about bushcraft and hiking and adventures, but if we were not talking about bushcrafting or hiking, we'd be talking about, or since we're talking about military survival and staying alive and behind enemy lines, that's what this pouch is more dedicated to. So in here, and in here is the more dedicated survival stuff. And so the first thing here is camo, and this is just whatever pattern I'd be wearing. Now, particularly because it is springtime, I actually find that desert, while a lot of people may not see this at first until I explain it to them, I actually love desert, because in the winter it blends in actually pretty well with the white snow, but especially in the latter part of the fall, in the early part of the spring, everything has this kind of deadish tan to it, because everything's still dead. It has this kind of deadish tan everything, and so I found that this camo coloration actually blends in insanely well in the latter fall when everything's died off, and in the early spring when everything's still dead. And so that's why I have this particular camo coloration, but I would have whatever coloration that I would be applicably using in that situation. The next thing I have is just an extra pair of wool socks. These are 85%ers, very useful. I love wool socks, regardless whether you're going in the summer, winter, fall, spring, whenever. Wool socks are always great. I find that they tend to wear the best, better than cotton socks, and as well, they keep your feet quite warm, but they can be breathable. And in addition, the big thing is, if your feet ever get wet, which they probably will at some point, whether it's because your feet sweat, or whether it's because you step in a puddle, or whether it's because you fall in a lake, whatever happens, you know, your feet will likely get wet at some point. Wool socks still keep you warm and will still provide insulation at that point. So the next thing I have in here, and I kind of always have these, is just snacks. And snacks, or just ready to eat something that's small, quick, light, and easy, is really great. And that's kind of the reason why I didn't choose any MREs. I also don't have any at this current moment, but what I really like about just Clif bars and quick bars like these is, unlike an MRE where you have to break into it and there's just a lot of food to deal with, these high calorie small bars like Clif Bars. They're really great because they're fast. You're just opening one meal here. You're not trying to open a big thing full of multiple meals. It's quick, it's fast, it allows you to continue to move. And once again, you don't have to pick up a lot. There's not a lot that you have to clean up after when you're done with a Clif Bar or any of these Kashi bars and stuff like that. So then the next thing is a very small stove. And once again, I could have chose a bigger like firebox stove, something's really in here, but I decided not to, in the fact that one, they're heavier, two, they're bigger than this, and three, this is really all you need. And once again, this is keeping very minimalistic. This is just a very old and very basic Esbit stove, and I have a few Esbit tabs in here. I also have some trioxane there and some tin foil here. This is just tin foil. There's nothing in it, to my knowledge. There's nothing in it, and that's just for cooking, but it's very small, tiny little aluminum, I believe it's aluminum, maybe it's steel, but I'm pretty sure it's aluminum fire stove. Once again, it's not big or really burly like some other fireboxes are, but this is also very small. It takes a very small amount of time to get it heated up, and once again, it allows you to have a very small fire. So if you do have to go with down the fire road, you know, you want to keep your fires as small as you can so as to not make any large alerts. So that's pretty much, oh no, okay, there's a few more things in here. I also, because it is still spring, have a couple pairs of hand warmers and that I really never change, and I don't think I would change actually, even if I were to go to a hostile environment, would be the IFAC. This is a true IFAC with all the military necessities like Israeli bandages and different things like that. And once again, I don't think I would change it just because you are dealing with lots of things like guns, knives, saws, things that can hurt you. But in addition to that, and even larger than that, now you have people that could possibly be hunting for you. And if they are hunting for you, they're not going to be hunting for you with nothing. They're going to have guns, they're going to have knives, they're going to have things that can do a lot of damage to you. So should you, for whatever reason, get hurt by those, it's important for you to be able to properly dress them and then move as fast as you can. So you don't want a lackluster emergency or, you know, first aid kit in this type of situation. So the next part over here is ammo, and this is generally where I keep my ammo normally, but for this particular situation, I've kind of buffed up the ammo. So as you guys already know, I'm running the Glock, so I'm carrying, aside from the magazine that's already in the gun, I'm carrying two extra magazines there, and then for the primary, and this is a little bit of a spoiler, it is a 22, but for the primary 22, I'm carrying 100 rounds here, 100 rounds here, 100 rounds here, and then you guys can't really see it, but there's two boxes of 50 rounds lower in there. So overall, I'm carrying 400 rounds of 22, and they are in varying velocities. The first box here was CV shorts, which are, you know, a smaller, they're actually 22 short, but the rest of it's all 22LR mini mags by CCI. So those are a little bit faster and a little bit more powerful. And once again, that would be something that you would have to understand your environment in which you could shoot which round, because the CB shorts really, when properly shot, they sound like essentially an air rifle, a 22 cal air rifle. So if you are worried or concerned that someone's hot on your trail, but you still need to hunt, you still need to get game, you just don't want to alert anyone to your presence, the CB shorts would be an excellent choice, because like I said, they sound like an air rifle when they're shot. Whereas if you fire off a mini mag, as the name kind of implies, it's pretty loud. I mean, it's not as loud as like a 45 ACP, and it's not as loud as like a full-on 30-06. That's way louder, but certainly if you're within a mile and a half of someone who's trying to hunt you, they're openly listening for noises, a CCI mini mag will alert them. So it's very important to know which one to use, and that's also one of the reasons why I wanted to include a CB short in there, is because it's very important sometimes when you're trying to not be found to buy some of you guys, because I think I've really only ever kept fire equipment in this top little pouch here, but I've really changed it up with this one. So this is essentially my PSK. So if I ever had to leave the backpack and go out, or for whatever reason, if I had to be detached from the backpack, this is what I would essentially carry on my body. And this is a, the base of this is a Maxpedition. What is this, a Maxpedition Janus, what is this, a pocket extension, but it's essentially all survivaled out. So starting off with the back of this, there is, in this one here, there is a Leatherman Surge, and then in this one here, these two pouches, this pouch here is a Benchmade 275 Adamas. Very tough and very rough knife, very great for tactical applications as well. Once again, the Surge, very capable. Then on the bottom of this, I have a Streamlight Stylus Pro for just a little bit of light. Once again, it's important to note that, you know, I don't want something ultra, ultra bright because I don't want to try and attract to what's actually in here. So one of probably the most important things that's in here is iodine tablets. This is something that many people in the special ops community really love because once again, they allow you to go down to, like, let's just say a lake and, you know, get up some water and just put a tablet or two in there and leave. No trace of that you had ever been there. And once again, there's no fire. There's no way of knowing that you had ever been there. So iodine tablets are very, very important for this. Next thing is a bandana, cotton bandana, tons of uses. I'm not gonna go over that. Then a little bit of paracord here, because once again, if I'm detached from this backpack, you know, it's great, it's fine, it's dandy to have like 500 feet of paracord here, but if I'm detached from the backpack, I don't have 500 feet of paracord. So it's nice to have just a little bit of, just a small roll of paracord just in case I need it. And like I said, pretty handy. Next thing is I have a Fox 40 Mini here, and that's a great little whistle. At some point, hopefully you'd be planning an evacuation. And so that's kind of why you do want some signaling material or something like, you know, a signal mirror, a whistle, because at some point, you know, toward the end, you will try and attract someone's attention. And that's why it's important to have a whistle, but you don't want to base your entire kit, unlike a normal survival kit, around trying to get people's attention. Next thing here is just a very basic sharpening rod, and it's the Spyderco Double Stuff. Very basic, but very important. I'm running quite a few blades here, as you can see. You know, I have four on the body, then there's two, maybe three, if you really want to count the multi-tool. So there's like three blades on this little setup alone, but there's lots of blades that you have to keep sharp. So having a some sort of sharpener is nice to have. Once again, because this is in the winter, I am running as well just one thing of, what is this, hand warmers. So that's very nice to have, you know, just in case for whatever reason. Once again, you are detached from the backpack with this little pack here, so it's nice to have some of these things that are in here as well. Next part is just a simple plastic bag. Once again, goes hand in hand with the iodine tablets of being able to go down to a water source, you know, fish up some water real stealthy and, you know, put a few iodine tablets in it and bam, you have drinkable water. So that's all that is in this little pouch. And I would probably, if I was using this for detachments, you know, like leaving this pack at a place and going off venturing, there's still some room in here and I would probably put some more stuff in this pouch for any special things that I might have to come across, or, you know, like I might put some extra ammo in there if I'm doing hunting, just different things. I would tailor it to whatever I was doing, but that's essentially the breakaway detachment from the backpack, and so that I can be prepared at all times, not just when I have the backpack around. So the next part here is, of course, the main compartment, and that's where 98% of all this gear is. Let's get into this. So the first thing you'll notice here, everything is camoed and dark colored, no bright things, not trying to get anybody's attention. But the first thing is this Mylar tarp, this Mylar / tarp material blanket. And as I've mentioned in several other videos, I really like this shelter setup of using this as a ground cloth and then using my larger tarp here as the covering of it. And I think that is very fast. On a normal day, I can set up that shelter that I'm talking about in about 15 minutes and have it taken down in about 10. So it's very fast. It works very reliably in keeping you warm. And overall, I think it's just a very effective shelter system, especially for this time of year. If we were in the heart of winter, I would be definitely buffing some of this stuff up. Like this would be replaced by my thicker tarp. But because this is spring going into summer, you know, I don't need as thick gear. So for this, I'm just rocking an Underground Quilt Company Winter Dream 11. And that is the tarp that goes above this kind of ground cloth here, essentially. And that would be my shelter system. Once again, it's insanely important to have a shelter system that you can set up 100% of your shelter, or at least 95% of your shelter, on your body. Because the last thing you want to do is be swinging an axe in a survival situation. Because another thing that not is often thought about is just how loud woods tools are in the woods. I mean, my friend and I, we've kind of talked about just how loud, like when you swing an axe, you can hear that thing echoing for quite a few seconds. And so once again, I'm not gonna say that if anybody's gonna be able to hear that, but if someone's specifically targeting you, these are the little things that they're gonna be able to hear because they have their ears perked to these noises. So being able to silently and efficiently set up an entire shelter without the necessity of cutting down wood, which is another thing, if you're walking along and someone's following you and they see, you know, a downed tree, they're gonna know that someone's there and someone's, you know, doing something with trees, and it's likely not some logger, you know. So that's very important to have, you know, a shelter that you can set up entirely in your back. Next thing is the rifle, and of course, as I mentioned, it's 22. This is an AR-7 in full camo. Once again, not trying to get any attention here, you know, trying to stay very low profile. I really like this setup. It sits very well in this pack, and once again, it's a 22. It allows me to hunt, but at the same time, I can do some defense with it if the need is pushed into it. With this one, I would be running 3 mags. I only have 2 because I just got the gun, so I have not had it long enough to really get an extra mag. I would be running this gun just like the Glock, so of course it'd be same there. And once again, I have 400 rounds for it, and including anything, I would be keeping all 3 magazines loaded up at all times because that's very important. So then the next thing is, I'm just going to pull this out because you guys really can't see it probably. Maybe you can. But this is the on-the-pack knife. I always like having an on-the-pack knife. It doesn't have to be big or burly. It just needs to be something, a nice knife. And I really like the Mora Garberg for this. This is an excellent survival and bushcraft knife. It's not very combative. If it was really pressed into the roll, I think it would be marginal at survival or at combat, but hey, something beats nothing. And like I said, it's a very good option to have in the backpack because 1, it's lightweight, 2, it's very stout, and 3, it's a good size. It works very well in the bush. So the next thing I have in here is tape, and once again, this is 1,000-mile tape. This is a military-style tape. This is what the military uses for their tape, so that's what this is. And I'm carrying a big roll of it because, once again, tape is a very important thing to have to correspond with the shelter. You know, if you have a patch or if you need to patch something, tape is a really good way to quickly patch something. And mobility is a very large portion of what I'm trying to focus on with this kit. Once again, this is an ultra mobile as you can get, full like survival kit is what I'm going for here. So the next part here is a Bible. This is a full-on military Bible. Hope you guys appreciate the military theme. Love the Bible. And I don't really care at what point, you know, if you're running from hostiles in a hostile environment, you know, it's this thing weighs, you know, a little bit. And this is the full Bible, but I still don't believe in jipping out. You know, have the full Bible on you. Doesn't matter where you are or what you're doing, have the Bible on you, because it's more important to have that than any of this other stuff, in my opinion. So have the Bible on you. And once again, this is a military Bible, so it's very small and compact, really easy to carry, but still you could easily fit something else in the same space it takes up, but I'm not doing that. So anyways, the next thing here is, you guys have probably been looking at this for quite some time. This is a Silky Big Boy, and this is for if you do have to process any firewood, if you do have to, you know, cut down a wrist thick tree to use as an upright for a shelter, you know, for whatever you have to do. I didn't want to have absolutely nothing, and I think the saw is good, not only because it's more precise or, you know, for whatever reason, but I actually like it because saws are a lot quieter than axes, because with an axe, you know, you're swinging this big thing and it's making a large percussion every single time you hit a tree with it, and that literally can alert people. I've actually alerted people with axes, so I'm not lying on that. Whereas with saws, it is very quiet, or it's not, I'm not gonna say it's very quiet, but it's significantly quieter than an axe, way quieter than an axe can be. And not to mention, you can also put them into more awkward situations where you may not be able to swing an axe. You know, overall, this is probably a better tool for this particular situation, because once again, we have to kind of take into mind here that you may be actually being stalked by people that are trying to capture you. So, you know, you want to take the silent option. You want to take an option that is effective, though. So the next part here is I'm rocking a stainless steel Nalgene 38 ounce, and inside here, I'm not going to pull it out, but inside there is a GSI Glacier cup that it's nesting in. You can probably hear it, like that noise. It is nesting in a stainless steel cup. That is quite important because, once again, I don't speculate to be boiling a lot of water, but you want to give yourself as many options as you can. So if you can boil water, you know, if you get the opportunity to do that, you want to have a bottle that has the capacity to do that. So the next thing is a simple bandana. Actually, I might carry two bandanas. I just realized that now. I'm actually carrying two bandanas. I totally didn't even realize that. I'm just gonna go with this because I think the second bandana is great. So two bandanas for this kit, one in the main and one for the kind of essentially exterior survival kit. So this thing's pretty jammed in here. Might not be able to get it out from this particular angle. But do trust my word, this is the MSR Seagull. It's a 675 milliliter stainless steel pot. Once again, as I've talked about expanding or using a larger pot, I don't think that's really necessary, especially in this particular circumstance where mobility is the key. You want what you need and not a lot of luxuries. So going for the smaller stainless steel pot is really handy, because it is less weight and you really just realistically don't need the cooking capacity of a larger pot. I put some of this stuff back. Hopefully you guys have enjoyed this look at this really fun and semi-serious look at a military survival kit. This is kind of what I would want, essentially, and that's what the whole preface to this was, that, you know, if I had to go behind enemy lines and possibly hide from aggressors trying to find me, you know, and or defend myself from them, this is the kind of survival kit, comprehensive survival kit. I just got a little bit busy putting stuff away, but like I was saying, this essentially is the kit that I would want if I had to go in behind enemy lines, possibly hide from aggressors who are openly trying to find, capture, and or kill me. And this is kind of would be the setup that I would go for. I think this would be a very effective setup, but of course, I don't have any military actual experience. I have not, you know, like gone truly behind, you know, Russian lines and like hid from people like that. So I'm not the expert on this, but this is just kind of my take, and especially coming from a survivalist's take of what I would try and incorporate if I was a survivalist and, you know, was dropped behind enemy lines. This is kind of what I would try and take. And hopefully you guys found this enjoyable. This is meant to ultimately be a, you know, not super serious kit, but once again, I get a lot of comments, you know, saying that they want to keep seeing these kits coming, and so I hope I can inspire some people here that even if you're not building a survival kit to go behind enemy lines or, you know, try and hide out in Russia from, you know, Spetsnaz or whatever, you know, this can hopefully give you guys some inspiration and maybe what you would incorporate into a bug out kit, because once again, you know, bug out situations are also could possibly be very similar to hiding from enemies, because certainly in a bug out situation there will be hostile people. So, you know, this could also parallel quite nicely into a bug out kit, many of these tools, and, you know, the overall keeping the whole thing of not being found, you know, is a very true factor. So hopefully you guys found some value in this. If nothing else, hopefully it was entertaining to kind of see how I would set this up. And that's it for now. I totally forgot to mention that I'd be running a water bladder on here, and this is a Camelback 100 ounce on the front of this, and you guys can see there I have it specially set up going through the bottom instead of the front as I usually have it. But just wanted to quickly note that I would likely as well be having that. This one's a little bit frozen at the moment, but I just wanted to throw that on there and mention that. That's another great thing to have an extra 100 ounces on you. So anyways, guys, that is truly it. And that's all I have for now. I'm out.